Zealand Defence Force, and thank you all for coming. Before I introduce the speakers, I'd just like to cover a couple of housekeeping matters. In the event of a fire, you'll exit the building from the way you came in, just behind me here. NZDF staff, as instructed and in accordance with our standard operating procedures, will muster or assemble on the courtyard just to the north of the National Library. You, of course, don't need to assemble with us, but I'm sure the camera people would love to come back and retrieve their gear in the event of an evacuation. In the event of an earthquake, remain where you are until given clearance to depart the building, and we'll give you instructions as to the safest route out. We may need to go to the lower ground level and exit out towards Aiken Street, so please sit where you are. The format for this afternoon's press conference is fairly simple. The Chief of the Defence Force, Lieutenant General Tim Keating, will lead the presentation. The Head of NZDF Legal Services, Colonel Lisa Ferris, will also make some comments on legal process. General Keating will then make some concluding remarks. This will take approximately 25 minutes. Then we are happy to take questions. Information writing to today's media conference will be sent out later today. I'd now like to introduce Lieutenant General Tim Keating and Colonel Lisa Ferris.
Good afternoon and thank you for coming. The purpose of today's briefing is to run through the events around Operation Burnham and the allegations contained in the book Hit and Run. The book contains serious allegations, and we in defence have taken the time, the necessary time, to carefully look at what has been alleged. Let me give you some background to Operation Burnham, the strike on 3rd of August 2010 on a PRT patrol. After the attack on the New Zealand Provincial Reconstruction Team, which killed Lieutenant Tim O'Donnell, the New Zealand PRT operating in Barmian Province did everything it possibly could to reduce the target profile of our people operating in the Shikara Valley and into the northeast of Barmian Province. We adjusted our routines, reduced movements to an absolute minimum, minimised night driving, and minimised the time in areas of high threat. The one thing the PRT couldn't do was have an effect on the individuals that attacked Lieutenant O'Donnell's patrol. For the first time, the insurgents had a major success, and they were well positioned to do so again. We knew in a matter of days from the attack from local and international security forces, ISAF, intelligence, who had attacked our patrol and the village that they came from. This group had previously attacked Afghan security forces and elements of the German and Hungarian provincial reconstruction teams. The valley they lived in, south of Talawabarfik and parallel to the Shikara Valley, was well away from where the Hungarian PRT operated, but was an easy walk to the border with Barmian and positions where they could attack the New Zealand Provincial Reconstruction Team patrols moving on the roads. The New Zealand government gave permission to use our SAS, who were operating in Kabul with the Afghan Crisis Response Unit, to see if they could help enhance the PRT security. Greater security would allow us to continue with the great progress that the PRT mission had achieved to date in Barmian Province. The Barmian success story was a threat to the Taliban, and it was clear that they were going to continue to undertake missions to disrupt our success. What followed was 14 days of reliable and corroborated intelligence collection that provided the confirmation and justification for subsequent actions. Based on the intelligence, deliberate and detailed planning was conducted. The bottom line, revenge was never a driver. We are a professional force. Our primary concern was the security of our people and that of the Afghani and other development people and government people working in the Bamiyan province. The conduct of this operation, as with numerous other New Zealand SAS operations in Afghanistan, would be led by the best intelligence available and executed with professionalism. New Zealand's Special Air Service had developed a strong international reputation, not only for operations in Afghanistan, but where they had operated on behalf of New Zealand in previous decades. A significant part of this reputation and why this force was favoured by successive governments was the combination of values they represented, everything that we cherish as New Zealanders, and the precision with which they could operate on complex operations where there are often blurred lines between combatants and non-combatants. What I would like to do now is to review some of the key elements of Hit and Run, the book that appears to build a case against the New Zealand Defence Force for war crimes committed against the people of Kakudaidar Village and Naik Village. As you will note from the book, the authors have been very precise in locating these villages with geo-reference points. So I have no doubt they are very accurate in the villages they are talking and taking the allegations from. The villages lie in the Turgaran Valley, some 2 kilometres north from Turgaran Village. In a straight distance, as a comparison, this is the distance between the Museum of Te Papa and Wellington Hospital. However, if you overlay the elevated terrain between those two northern villages and Turgaran Village, you will see we're talking about a significant distance, a significant separation, two very distinct settlements to the north, which are not Turgaran Village. The authors have provided some clear and detailed accounts as to what their sources say occurred in Kakudaidar Village and Naik Village, which provides the basis of their claims that there were serious grounds for consideration of whether war crimes had been committed. Briefly, some of these accounts include helicopter landing sites, location of houses that were destroyed, locations of where civilians were allegedly killed, a presumed location of an SAS sniper with evidence presented of SAS ammunition and water bottles which were found at the site. A relationship was therefore drawn between the sniper location and the alleged killing of the individual as Lumudin, the schoolteacher. The book provides detailed lists of the dead and the wounded from Kakudaidar Village and Naik Village. It also provides detailed lists of the houses destroyed in Kakudaidar Village and Naik Village. The underlying premise of the book is that New Zealand's SAS soldiers conducted an operation on Kakudaidar Village and Naik Village, inflicted considerable damage to property, deliberately killed civilians, which add up to war crimes that need to be investigated. It seems to me that one of the fundamentals a start point of any investigation that I might like to call into an alleged crime is to tie the alleged perpetrators of a crime to the scene of a crime. Then we examine the motive, the means, and other evidence. Let me now detail to you the ISAF operation, Operation Burnham, which was conducted in Turgaram village. Operation Burnham was planned around a sound intelligence picture. A feature of all NZSAS operations was the involvement on the planning, the conduct, the subsequent debriefs, and a review of the operation by a lawyer. New Zealand was one of the first in the ISAF coalition to adopt this practice of legal oversight, which was aimed to provide a level of additional assurance to the commander and the troops on the ground that their actions were within the operational directive, and any offensive actions were within the rules of engagement. Further, the plan was notable for its attention to detail to avoid civilian casualties. Again, as I've stated earlier, this is why Special Forces soldiers are better suited to this type of operation, as their training enables them to make rapid decisions in the face of a dynamic environment. To summarise, to use an appropriate level of force or not. I will now turn to the conduct of Operation Burnham. The operation commenced on the night of 21-22 August. The operation mission, which included New Zealand Special Air Service soldiers, aimed to detain Taliban insurgent leaders who were threatening the security and stability of the Bamiyan province, and to disrupt their operations and their operational network. Operation Burnham was conducted some 2 kilometres to the south of Kapudedad village and Naik village, and a village, as I previously stated, called Turgaram village. What I wish to introduce you to now briefly is Squadron Leader Leon Fox will give us an explanation of the map-to-ground analysis comparing and contrasting Operation Burnham to the 2 locations in the book.
Good afternoon. As you can clearly see from the 2 locations up there that we're discussing, they are significantly different. The area to the north, where the alleged offending took place, is based in a relatively dry valley running east to west. There's also a significant high ground just to the south of the villages. In contrast, the area to which Operation Burnham occurred is based at the confluence of 2 rivers in a mainly north-south valley with the opening ground to the south. So as discussed, the east-west valley, the high ground here, with the north-south valley here opening up to the south. These 2 locations are approximately 2 kilometres apart, with 4 major ridgelines in between. There is no direct line of sight between either one. As you can see, there can be no confusing with these 2 locations. One is based in the east-west valley, the other in the north-south. One has significant high ground to the south, the other has opening ground to the south. One is a dry valley, the other is a lush green confluence of rivers. Thank you.
I will now provide you a detailed account of Operation Burnham. The New Zealand Special Air Service and partner ground forces arrived at this helicopter landing zone at 0030 on the 22nd of August 2010. They were provided covering support by coalition aircraft. The role of these aircraft was to provide protection to the ground forces. The ground force commander was a New Zealand Special Air Service officer who controlled both the ground activities and provided clearance after the appropriate criteria had been met by any involvement of the coalition air element. These elements were coordinated by an air controller in his location. The criteria that had to be met before air engagement was used was the target had to be positively identified as a direct participant in the hostilities, that the person was satisfied that any collateral damage would be minimised. On arrival of the ground patrols by helicopters, numbers of insurgents with weapons were identified leaving the village to take up positions on the high ground and within the village, which were deemed appropriately by the ground force commander to threaten the elements of the ground force. Upon meeting the necessary criteria within the rules of engagement, coalition aircraft were given permission to engage these insurgent groups. Meanwhile, the ground forces entered a number of the buildings where intelligence had indicated insurgent leadership was staying. While the insurgent leaders themselves had left, significant quantities of weapons and ammunition, including rocket-propelled grenades, machine guns, pistols, were found and destroyed at the site. During the destruction of the ammunition, two dwellings caught fire, one through exploding ammunition falling on the roof, and one by an unattended cooking fire in the dwelling. The SAS suffered one casualty who was injured by falling debris during the operation. As mentioned previously, the planning went to great lengths to protect all civilians on the ground, and this was followed through meticulously by the ground force during the conduct of the operation. Part of this included a procedure known as call-out, where before entering the village, the ground force announced their presence with loud hailers and the intention to the village, advising them that this was an ISAF Afghan security forces operation. The obvious downside of this approach is that it gave away the element of surprise for the ground forces and allowed the insurgents time to respond, thereby putting the ground forces at greater risk to enhance the protection of the civilians. A feature of the majority of SAS operations during this deployment in Afghanistan was the limited number of times SAS personnel fired their weapons. During Operation Burnham, the SAS fired two rounds, two bullets. They were targeted at an insurgent who was approaching one of the ground force positions. The insurgent was shot and killed. I reiterate, two rounds were fired by the ground force during that operation. The SAS forces left Turgaran village at 0345 on the 22nd of August. ISAF subsequently approved a second mission to Turgaran on the night of the 2nd and 3rd of October, following further intelligence confirming insurgent activity in the area. The mission was completed by the New Zealand Special Air Service and Afghan Security Forces. No shots were fired. A building was searched that was empty, and the only explosive used during the mission was a small charge to gain entry through the door. Once again, prior to entering the building and the village, a call-out procedure was used. Let me now turn to the ISAF Afghan government inquiry. Some days after the operation, the provincial governor of Baghlan province, Governor Moji, received a delegation of villagers who claimed that a very big operation had occurred with helicopters, that some landed and the operation was firing at civilians and left. The locals claimed six civilians were killed, four adult males, one adult female, and one child aged six. Additionally, there were two adult females being treated in a local hospital for wounds. A I would now like to introduce our Head of Defence Legal Service, Colonel Lisa Ferris, who will explain the ISAF investigation process.
Good afternoon. At the outset, I think it is important to highlight that the situation in Afghanistan was considered by New Zealand to be one of non-international armed conflict. Accordingly, the legal framework governing the conduct of members of the armed forces was one regulated by international humanitarian law, also known as the law of armed conflict. For the purposes of this brief, I will refer to the law of armed conflict as the applicable legal framework. For many of these operations, the New Zealand Defence Force will also develop its own rules of engagement. These rules are drafted with input from legal officers, operators, and are signed off to the highest level, in this instance, from the Prime Minister of the day. These rules can never exceed the limits of the law of armed conflict. All members of the armed forces, and indeed all members of this deployment, are required to undergo training in the law of armed conflict. It is a baseline training requirement for all members of the armed forces. All members of this deployment undertook specific pre-deployment training that incorporated briefs and scenario-based training that involved the application of the rules of engagement. All personnel were also issued with a code of conduct card which outlined their obligations under international law. As part of this deployment, as the Chief of Defence Force has highlighted, the New Zealand Defence Force was something of a pioneer, and that we sent a legal officer to accompany the deployment at the tactical level. This has not occurred, to my knowledge, in respect of Special Forces deployments before. That legal officer, a qualified barrister and solicitor, and experienced military lawyer, was deployed with the SAS in order to provide briefings and ongoing training on the law of armed conflict and the rules of engagement. The legal officer was also present with the senior commander during Operation Burnham and provided a debrief to personnel after the event. The legal officer deployed on that mission did not observe any activity during or in relation to Operation Burnham which gave them any cause for concern around compliance with the law of armed conflict or the rules of engagement. It is a tragic reality that civilian casualties occur in a time of armed conflict. Civilian casualties, however, are not necessarily unlawful at international law. Subsequent information received after Operation Burnham indicated that civilian casualties may have been possible. The International Security Assistance Force was required to assess all allegations of possible civilian casualties and was required to notify such instances to the United Nations Assistance Mission in Afghanistan and the International Committee of the Red Cross. As part of this reporting of civilian casualties, ISAF stood up an investigation team headed by a Brigadier General and supported by personnel from ISAF, including a legal officer, as well as representatives from the government of the Islamic Republic of Afghanistan, from both the Ministry of Interior and the Ministry of Defence. That report made recommendations as to any further actions to be undertaken by ISAF and or the troop contributing nations. The investigation team concluded that civilian casualties may have been possible due to the malfunction of a weapon system, as was made public by ISAF in their statement of the 29th of August 2010. The investigation team also concluded that members of the SAS appear to have complied with the commander's tactical directive, the rules of engagement, and accordingly, the law of armed conflict. The investigation concluded that no further action be taken. The New Zealand Defence Force was provided with a summary of that report and its conclusions. Allegations of war crimes are a serious matter. The New Zealand Defence Force has a legal obligation to investigate allegations that are well-founded in accordance with Section 102 of the Armed Forces Discipline Act 1971. The possibility of civilian casualties in an armed conflict does not necessarily mean that a criminal act has occurred. The law of armed conflict accepts that sometimes mistakes and errors, such as equipment malfunction, may happen in times of armed conflict. if individuals have information pertaining to members of the New Zealand SAS and their conduct, then we encourage them to come forward and make a formal statement to the New Zealand Defence Force, either to any member of command or to the New Zealand Defence Force Military Police. Likewise, the New Zealand Police also has jurisdiction in respect of serious crimes, such as war crimes.
I'd now like to conclude before taking questions. New Zealand's Armed Forces have a reputation as a force for New Zealand that represents New Zealand and its values, and a force for good in the world. Our Armed Forces are deployed representing New Zealand into the most challenging environments. These are environments the average New Zealander would not welcome being in, where there is often great risk to personal health and safety. It is the nature of service in our armed forces. It is my responsibility to train your service people, to give them a strong sense of values and ethics, so they can represent New Zealand with a character that we would all want displayed as New Zealanders. The clear contrast to me between the book and what actually happened during Operation Burnham was that in all respects, the conduct of the New Zealand Ground Forces was exemplary. It is always in our best interests that we, the New Zealand Defence Force, are the harshest critics of ourselves. Our reputation is our currency. This enables us to maintain our professional reputation by constantly challenging ourselves. It's a reputation for which we hold high because we're known by it internationally. It's not only a New Zealand Defence Force reputation, it's the New Zealand reputation we're talking about here. For us, we call it relentlessly pursuing excellence. Near enough is gone, not good enough. And we'll fight for every time that we've got something wrong. And we'll fix it. During Operation Burnham, there was no cause for the Chief of Defence Force of the day to question the conduct of the operation. A substantive review of the information that I have available does not cause me to question that conduct again, other than note that it is exemplary on the evidence that has been produced to me. Our service personnel remain committed to their profession and to achieving mission success, but always within the bounds of the laws of armed conflict. I remain proud to serve in and lead New Zealand's Defence Force and stand up for them when they're on the side of right. I remain proud of the role the New Zealand Defence Force undertakes on behalf of New Zealand, both here and around the world. And I'm sure most New Zealanders are proud of that role also. Thank you.
Were any of the villagers killed by Apache gunship fire during Operation Burnham?
Which village? Operation Burnham, well, let's be clear about what we're talking about.
Well, during the operation.
So during Operation Burnham, the coalition aircraft engaged insurgent groups, not villagers. As the ISAF report has said, and said publicly, some civilians may have occurred because of a mishap with a gun.
But those investigators weren't able to get to the village, according to the UN report, annual report in 2010. So
it's not that they may have not been available to get to the village, but a complaint was made to the governor by some villagers.
Are you aware of any attacks on the other two villages that could have been confused with Operation Burnham?
No.
Has New Zealand ever been involved have anyone from New Zealand forces been involved or been to those villages at all, at any time?
To the two northern villages, no.
Can we go one at a time, please, guys?
So they have been. Tuggeran was where Operation Burnham was conducted, 2 kilometres south of the two northern villages that are mentioned in the book.
So can you confirm that people were killed, but you're saying that they're insurgents?
Insurgents were killed during Operation Burnham.
And how can you be sure that they were insurgents as opposed to civilians or villagers?
Because under the rules of engagement, they were engaged as meeting the criteria of insurgents that threatened the operation, and we have camera footage.
Have you cross-referenced the names mentioned in the book of those casualties and the insurgents that you believe killed by the NZDF?
No, those casualties mentioned in the book, or the names mentioned in the book, are from a village, two villages to the north, that we have not visited. We have no knowledge of those villages.
So there could have been an attack on those villages by other forces?
Highly unlikely. And certainly not on the same night.
Then
although there was some distance, I think we would have heard it.
Where did those deaths come from then? That delegation of villagers that went to the governor to say that their villagers had been killed. In your view, how do you think those villagers may have died?
Look, there's a variety of reasons that delegations of villagers may come to a local authority to complain about actions. Where they came from, the governor and the team know that they came from the Baglan province. But it's often a feature after coalition operations for locals to present themselves and talk about what happens in operations.
So how many insurgents were killed during Operation Boom?
A significant number of insurgents, identified insurgents, were killed during Operation Boom.
But how many? Because there's
nine.
Conflicting...
Nine.
Do you have the
Definitely
names of
nine.
Do you have the names of those insurgents?
No.
Can you release them?
No.
Will you
do
release
not have the names
cameras?
Of insurgents.
Will you release the camera footage if you're saying that what that backs up the fact that the rules
camera
of engagement
footage is only sort of released, it's classified information, and we can release it for those with the appropriate security classification.
Does that expire after a certain time?
Pardon?
Does that expire after a certain
actually,
time?
Actually, we're checking with the coalition to see if that's available. But again, it's that camera footage, one, provides irrefutable evidence of what was being engaged by the coalition aircraft, and two, it's geo-referenced, so it gives the location of where those engagements occurred.
I
have seen it.
How many times did the coalition aircraft fire?
A number of occasions.
You were in the village for over 3 hours, so that's quite a long period of time, potentially.
Yeah, because the search took a long time,
yeah.
And the group that went to the high ground, so I'm not going to guess there, but they had a number of engagements and killed nine insurgents. But could I say, though, that the ground, the SAS ground commander, denied a number of calls for fire, so based on the grounds, including when the coalition force was leaving, the ground force was leaving the LZ, a request was made from fire by the coalition, and the ground force commander chose at that time there was no longer a threat and they were leaving.
So all of that fire was caught from the Apaches was called in by the New Zealand air controller?
No, it's coordinated by the New Zealand air controller. So the aircraft themselves can identify targets, but it has to be, they can't fire until the New Zealand commander gives clearance to fire. So a ground force patrol on the ground can say, we have an armed insurgent in front of us, we face a risk. This is part of this check. So it then goes back to meet the criteria. So the ground force commander has to be satisfied that it meets the two criteria that were put up on the screen.
Did forces return to the village at a later date?
I explained that in the brief, that they returned to the village in early October, I think early October.
But not in the short time frame mentioned in the book?
No. Well, the book's talking about returning to another village.
So has the Defence Force not seen a full copy of the ISAF Afghan report? You just referred to a summary?
It's not normal for an organisation to get it. And again, ISAF do lots of... Every time there's a report of a civilian casualty, these reports are numerous. I've actually requested that report to read it. However, I'd be very surprised if there's anything else in there outside the executive summary. If there had have been, I'm sure the CDF of the day would have requested the full report.
Can I just come back to my previous question about the fact that whether the investigators got to Tiggeran to talk to the villagers or interview anybody in terms of that report's based on.
So what's your question?
Did the investigators carrying out the ISAF Afghan assessment review ever get to the scene where...
This was an ISAF investigation. To the best of my knowledge, no, because the complaint was made that the governor was leading it on behalf of the villagers. The governor appears to have been satisfied once he reviewed the material provided by ISAF that there was no further case to answer.
So it really comes back to that camera footage that you were talking about in that case, in terms of the fact that they were insurgents as opposed to civilian or villagers.
And the governor reviewed that footage.
Right, so he saw that.
Just on those civilian deaths, do you know how many there may have been? How come they can't say either way if they're definitely...
How many of...
Of those civilian casualties that the ISAF report says there may have been some. Why is it only a maybe, and do you know how many it may have been?
So the reason being, and again, in this type of conflict, is the insurgents, your guerrilla force, the tactic is to mix them with the civilian population. If you like, the term used is a human shield. So they use civilians as a shield. What occurred is a helicopter was engaging a group of insurgents outside the village, on the outskirts of the village. During that engagement, it was noted by the ground forces, the SS ground forces, that some of the rounds were falling short and went into a building where it was believed there were civilians as well as armed insurgents. It is noted that the building, there were armed insurgents in there, but is believed there may have been civilians in the building. So the weapon malfunctioned and some rounds went in that building. There is no confirmation that any casualties occurred, but there may have been.
Was it correct that CDF at the time, Jerry McFly, watched the operation from the base camp?
I know General Matterpryor was in Afghanistan at the moment. I haven't talked to him about what his actions were throughout the operation, so I don't know.
Watched it.
Who was in control of that misfire, the weapon that went off in the helicopter?
Well, it's not a misfire. What the technical reason was the sight wasn't slaved to the barrel correctly. As soon as it was noted that rounds were falling short, that gun was so the SAS ground controller said you cannot use that helicopter, the gun, and the crew knew it as well. So who's in control? The pilot was controlled, the gunner was in control, but he stopped once he noticed that he had a gun that was not firing properly.
So how was it determined that there were no civilians in that building?
I've said there were civilians in that building.
So I'm just going to ask you, how did you determine whether there were any deaths or not in that building, if no one actually went to the village subsequently?
Well, this is what we say, they may have occurred.
Can I just clarify your statement from March 21, though, where you say that allegations of civilian casualties were unfounded?
Yep.
How does that tally with what you're saying?
Well, I think that's a word that they use, which I think is unfounded. It comes back to that report, and that's the official response. There may have been, as opposed to unfounded. You could look. I'm not going to get cute here and say it's a twist on words, but it's the same thing. Unfounded. There may have been. The official line is there may have been casualties.
But they're different things. One means they didn't happen.
Yeah,
one means they might have done.
You're right. It does, Tracy. The official line is that civilian casualties may have occurred, but not corroborated.
So how well was the then Minister of Defence brief on the operation?
Very well.
How do you reconcile the comments that he made last week? Because they appeared to back up the allegations made by Mr. Stephenson and Mr. Hagar.
Which comments in specific?
Referencing the issue that the operation was a fiasco.
There's no briefing that we gave the Minister of Defence which would infer that the operation was a fiasco, quite the contrary.
Are you in any position to explain the comments?
You'd have to ask Dr. Matt where he drew the information from to make that comment.
If there may have been civilian casualties, why not have an inquiry to find out so this all stops?
I think what the legal staff officer has pointed out is that, you know, civilian casualties in war are an unfortunate element of war. There has been no evidence produced from the village that we operated in that have presented to the satisfaction of the governor and the authorities of Afghanistan that casualties occurred in that village.
But
even if there was, as far as the New Zealand Defence Force occurred, the coalition investigation has said that if there were casualties, the fault of those casualties was a mechanical failure of a piece of equipment.
But if you say our reputation is our currency and this effectively could have happened under our watch, isn't it better to clear it up with the public as to whether any civilians died?
Well, I think it's quite clear from the investigation, so it's not on our authority, so it's an ISAF mission. So I'm not sure what type of investigation we'd undertake as the New Zealand Defence Force in this mission or a variety of missions where claims are made of civilian casualties.
So what do you think then of the idea of another independent inquiry led by a judge or someone else independent of every party?
Every inquiry has to have, again, what Colonel Ferris has laid out, every inquiry has to have some sort of legal basis. If you're going to question people under procedures of evidence and so on, you can't just have an inquiry. What I've done is laid out what's happened throughout the operation. I've done it to our political leadership. I've produced evidence that the reports that we have are factual. And I think it's irrefutable that we operate in a different area to the claims of the book.
Would you have an issue with an inquiry then?
I wouldn't have an issue, but legally it would be a little bit of a challenge, so compelling people to give evidence. But reviewings, this is what I'm doing, this is my role under the Armed Forces Discipline Act on behalf of New Zealand and maintaining a disciplined armed force. You know, it is not in their interest to push stuff under the carpet. It is in my interest to see if the conduct of New Zealanders on operations is less than exemplary.
Did you show the political leaders the video footage you've got, film footage?
No. Will you release documents then, given the public interest in this?
What sort of documents?
Will you release material you have relating to Operation Burnham?
I'll release what we can release to prove our location, but as you've seen from the presentation, it's the underlying premise of the book. Are we talking about what we? So again, coming to question, is your question about what we did in Operation Burnham, or the allegations made in the book of a place that we weren't at?
Operation Burnham. Will you release what you can release to put the public's mind at ease?
I'd be more than satisfied to release what we can. That in the village where the SAS operated, that I'll back our statement that the conduct of our people on the ground there, and in fact all people on that operation, including the coalition aircraft, was exemplary.
Do you have film footage of the October visit to the village, or just the August?
No, I don't have film of the October.
We have time for one more question, please.
Do you think, what's your opinion of the book? Was it a responsible piece of journalism, in your opinion?
I'm not going to comment on that. You know, the authors are obviously distinguished and gathered a lot of information, but it's not on an operation that NZSA has conducted.
Thank you.